welcome to yet another edition of Ask Housing. I'm Jamal Ghosh, editor in chief, Housing.com News, and our guest on the show today is Priyanjali Singh, who's the advocate on record for the Supreme Court of India. Priyanjali, great to have you with us. I would like to tell our audience members that you have been so incredibly busy and it's been difficult to pin you down, but you have made time for us. So thank you so much for being here with us.
Jamal, my pleasure, and I'm so sorry that I left you hanging for some time.
No, that's not a problem at all. We understand how busy you are. So Priyanjali, the whole point of having you on our show is that, you know, we have a lot of our readers and viewers, you know, who write into us, you know, with various legal matters, you know, that they need clarity on, you know, they want some knowledge, they want some expertise. So, you know, we are just going to sort of touch upon some of the important, you know, or crucial pain points, you know, that home buyers are facing. And we would really like us to, you know, that you could share your legal opinion and expertise on these matters. So I will start off with one of the most interesting cases, you know, that you've worked on in recent times. And it's been an interesting case for the sector. It has far-reaching, you know, implications in terms of being a precedent. And I'm talking about the Imperia versus Anil Patni case, you know, where the Supreme Court, you fought that case in the Supreme Court, you won it. And the Supreme Court ruled that even if there is a pending litigation in RERA, a home buyer still has the right to approach the consumer fora. So it would be great if you could explain to us, A, what was the case about in brief? And secondly, why is this judgment so important, especially for home buyers?
Jumar, the case started out as a normal consumer case. Basically, there were many of us, not just Mr. Anil Patni, but other allottees also. And they had a common grievance. The grievance was they had booked flats in a project called Esfera in Gurgaon. Those flats were supposed to be delivered by 2016, 2017, and they did not get delivered. Hence, they approached the NCDRC, that is the National Consumer Disputes Redressal Commission at Delhi. That's the apex consumer body in India. They filed individual complaints. And when we filed individual complaints, because the matters were similar, they were later on disposed of by a common judgment. This judgment of 12th of September 2018 gave a verdict in the favor of allottees. They were granted refund along with 9% interest and even an escalated interest in case the builder does not pay that 9%. What happened thereafter is that the builder decided to just sit on the judgment and do nothing. Therefore, we did our bit. We filed execution petitions in the NCDRC. That's when he woke up and went to the Supreme Court and filed an appeal. It is his right to file an appeal, but he deliberately dragged his feet and filed it with more than 100 days of delay. There, he took two legal points. Rather than contesting us on the factual aspects of the case, he said two very, very vital things. One, the judgment was bad because the NCDRC could not have dealt with our case. The reason is RERA Act 2016 had come into force in 2017, and he felt, or it was his position, that the RERA Act banned all housing cases from going anywhere except to RERA. Hence, he felt NCDRC was lacking jurisdiction and he could not have delivered any such judgment. That is one. The second, shall we say, alternative plea which he took was that the NCDRC complaint, we call our cases complaints in NCDRC because we are complaining against the builder. So this complaint, he said, was premature. The reason is that the RERA deadlines, as given by the builder himself, remember the builders register under RERA and they voluntarily suo moto give these deadlines, which will be totally different from those given in our agreements. So those deadlines had not yet expired. Hence, he said, wait for the deadlines to expire, the RERA deadlines to expire, and if he is not able to deliver by those deadlines, only then we can complain. Now, the Supreme Court was kind enough to hear very detailed arguments, and thereafter, last year, it finally gave a judgment in the favor of allottees, and it laid down two groundbreaking principles. One, RERA Act solely bars civil courts. You can't file a civil suit in a normal court. But at the allottee's discretion, if the allottee so desires, he can choose to go to the consumer forum. He can choose to go to the RERA also.
Yeah.
But he has an alternative remedy available under the Consumer Protection Act. Therefore, as far as jurisdiction issues goes, it was held on our side.
Yeah.
The second issue was, it said that the only deadlines to be considered for the purpose of computing delay in delivery were the deadlines as specified by the agreement. Now, all allottees sign these agreements. They're called allotment letters, application forms, builder buyer agreements, apartment buyer agreements, any name whatsoever. They all have a common clause that the builder shall endeavor. He'll not say, I shall deliver, I shall endeavor, or I'll try to, or he'll use any number of qualifications, but there's a deadline given. Yeah. Now, what the Supreme Court said is, it is these deadlines which are sacrosanct.
Yeah.
The RERA deadlines do not get used for computing the delay in delivery.
Yeah.
So that confusion, which was besetting most of the courts, including the consumer forums and a lot of, lawyers also.
Yeah.
So that was set at rest. So
yeah.
Both the issues were decided in the favor of allottees. So it was really very good for us and has set the right precedent for the future cases.
Yeah. You know, it's interesting, you know, you mentioned this aspect because we've also been receiving a lot of letters, you know, from our readers and our viewers, you know, that which is the date, you know, that has to be followed. Is it the allotment letter? Is it the date, you know, that's mentioned on the RERA website? And I have to say this, you know, that this appears to be a loophole that, you know, some people have used to their advantage. So I think it's great, you know, that there's been clarity provided on that point as well. Now, I sort of want to ask you like an allied question. And this is again, our viewers have reached out to us with this confusion. So RERA, of course, you know, everybody respects the adjudicating authority. They have brought in a lot of legal clarity, you know, into the market. But there's also a perception, especially as far as home buyers are concerned, that RERA is not very refund friendly. And if you look at a lot of home buyers whose homes are stuck in projects which have been indefinitely delayed, their only concern is that, you know, I just want, you know, the money that I have invested so far, I just want that principal amount to be safeguarded. I want that money back. I want to get out of this project because I'm not in a position to wait any longer. So the question that we get from our viewers is that, how do I decide that this kind of a complaint, should I be going to RERA? Should I go to the consumer forum? Is there some, you know, clarity that you can give us, you know, that if there's some kind of a confusion, how should a home buyer sort of navigate this?
So the answer actually would be that I would have to judge each case and give an advice on the basis of facts of the case. But on a generic level, yes, I can make certain statements.
Yeah.
Firstly, it is not incorrect to say that the priority of RERA does seem to be that the project gets constructed and completed.
Yeah.
Hence, it has given certain judgments and orders wherein it says, if I pull out certain money and refund these allottees, then how will the project continue?
Yeah.
And there will be a large number of allottees who might be put at risk, and their future will be put at risk. It seems to be doing a balancing role. It seems. I'm not supporting it or criticizing it, but that is the ground principle it seems to be applying. Saying that, please do understand, RERA does give refund.
Yeah.
In fact, in the same Imperia case, it seems that the Supreme Court might even have said that if refund is asked for, RERA has to give it. I am using the word seems because it was not technically an issue which was raised before the court, and in legal language, any observations by the court which are not on issue may not be perfectly and fully binding. But let me put it this way, I would not say that allottee should lose faith in RERA.
Yeah.
But now let us look at the ancillary question, which is therefore required to be answered, which is, then what? She's saying RERA is also good. She's saying consumer forum is also good. Then what? So again, I come back to the facts of the case, because the problem is that everybody firstly need not want to go to a consumer forum. Everybody may not be able to go to the consumer forum. And when I say able, I'm not talking about the practical difficulties. There are legal difficulties involved. Consumer Protection Act is meant for consumers. Now, consumers effectively, and this is a very simplistic thing I'm saying, it is way more complicated, but it means it is meant for end users. It's not for commercial purposes, not for investment purposes. The idea is not to short circuit the entire process for benefit of people who are out there to make money.
Yeah.
So this was supposed to be a specialized forum for a small segment of people. So one of the first objections which a builder takes is that, look, you are not a consumer. So if the facts of your case are such that you will go on the defensive, or you will get stuck in a technical tangle only on whether you're a consumer or not, then maybe you should consider just going to RERA. That is one thing which you have to see.
Yeah.
And please understand one more thing, that the new Consumer Protection Act 2019 has now come.
Yeah.
A lot of things have changed.
Yeah.
One of the biggest attractions earlier was that we could go directly to the NCDRC. Because if you could make out a case where the amount in the complaint was more than 1 crore, you could go to the NCDRC. Now, Consumer Protection Act has, the new one, has completely changed the methodology and the thresholds.
Okay.
So what has happened is, look at the difference in the thresholds first.
Okay.
Up till 1 crore, you have to go to the district forum. Earlier, it used to be the NCDRC. See, the attraction is already gone. Earlier, it was the apex body which you were approaching. Now, it is the lowest tier of the entire hierarchy.
Yeah.
Then from 1 crore to 10 crores, it'll go to the state commission.
Okay.
From 10 crores onward, it goes to the NCDRC. The second problem, and it's actually an issue, is the methodology of calculating this valuation. We call it pecuniary jurisdiction.
Yeah.
Just for simplicity, we'll call it valuation.
Okay.
That methodology has changed. Now, the only thing they see is, how much have you paid?
Yeah.
Now, if you have a 10 crore flat and by chance you paid 40 lakhs, you'll go to the district forum.
Wow.
Okay. So, see the problem. Earlier, we all used to make a beeline that somehow we have to reach the NCDRC, because after NCDRC, there's only the Supreme Court and things will get wrapped up. And we had trust and faith in both these institutions. We still have. So, but the problem is now you may not be able to file in these, in the NCDRC. So now you will probably take as much time in the consumer fora as you will in RERA.
Yeah.
So again, therefore, you'll have to take a decision maybe on other grounds as to what choice you wish to make.
Yeah.
One major thing which might weigh with you is accessibility of courts. Now, I'll give you an example. I am an allottee who is a salaried professional working in Bangalore. And I have purchased a flat in Gurgaon. Now, if I want to approach RERA, I'll have to go to RERA Gurgaon.
Yeah.
I will have to engage a lawyer there and do all paperwork in RERA Gurgaon.
Yeah.
Because as per RERA, the only place you can file is where the project is situated.
Yeah.
Whereas the Consumer Act, the new one especially, is highly flexible.
Yeah.
It says even where you stay, you can file a case.
Okay.
So he can go ahead and file it. Suppose it was in the district forum, then he can file it in whichever district he's actually staying in.
Yeah.
So yes, he might have other problems like language in my example, which I'm giving. But the fact is, accessibility is very much there.
Okay.
So that is one thing. The second thing is, Rera is turning out to be mildly faster. It is actually faster, but I have qualified it by mildly because it is still a new court. It is undergoing certain teething troubles. The teething troubles are that almost everything is getting challenged in the courts above. And I'm not talking about the merits of the case. The technical sides of it are getting challenged. An example is, who can hear refund cases? Whether it is the adjudicating authority who can hear, or is it the RERA authority, who the chairperson, whether he can take up such cases? Imagine this simple issue has gone up till the Supreme Court. Till this issue is decided, all the refund cases keep going in circles. So that is why I'm saying it is supposed to be faster, but currently I would say things are getting a little bogged down. Over a period of time, maybe these hitches will be sorted out and it will become... See, the advantage of consumer courts is that they have been there for decades. So everything is set and all the procedures are very streamlined. So very soon we'll have that in RERA also. But currently, there is a little work in progress kind of situation.
So one of the major pain points or, you know, issues of dispute, you know, between the builder and the home buyer has been that of parking spaces. Now, in the past, we have seen judgments, you know, where it has been ruled that this is a public space, you know, you cannot sell it. Builders have continued to sell it. Home buyers have continued to buy it. Has there been any update on that? Has there been a change in the laws as far as parking spaces are concerned?
There's been a lot of developments in that field. And I would like to start with my conclusion, which is that the law is still work in progress. I've used that word earlier, but it is better than using the word that it is very inchoate at this stage. The reason is that we all got that very, very happy news. I think it was the year 2010 when the Supreme Court had, in the case of Nahal Chand, this was the Maharashtra case, which had come up to the Supreme Court. It had said that the builder cannot charge for open parking and stilt parking. The rationale which was given was that they could not be treated as garages. I will just go one step back just to explain, because I am sure this has confused. The builder, as per the Maharashtra Act, the relevant Maharashtra Act, was allowed to sell flats. He was also allowed to sell something called garages. But like all builders, he was selling parking spaces. So when the society objected, the question which was raised was whether these stilt parkings, and please understand, stilt parkings are above the ground and below the first floor, and open spaces, whether they would be considered as garages and therefore they could be sold or not. And the Supreme Court came down heavily against the builder. It said, look, this is common area. You're already charging for it proportionally from the allottees. So you can't charge it again. And this has to be sold along with the flat. It can't be sold separately. Now, the rationale was applied to almost all states. I think even the builders presumed that this set the law against them, which is why they changed their terminology. They stopped selling parkings and they started selling what was called exclusive right to use. And the rationale is, and this is an aside, I'll just come back to the Supreme Court thing. The problem with not having exclusive right to use is that you would not have individual exclusive parkings. If it was a common area, then anybody would say, I want to park here. Why should you park in front of your flat? I mean, that is actually a practical problem which would have to be faced. So they were using that same logic that, look, this is exclusive right to use. We are kind of marking this particular area for a flat. Hence, we are giving and charging the amount for that. So this ended up with some amount of judgments, but last year a new judgment has come, and it is called Wing Commander Arifur Rahman versus DLF case. And a very progressive judgment otherwise, and a very, very important judgment. But interestingly, one of the issues which was raised was this parking issue.
Okay.
And this case came from Karnataka. The society involved was in Karnataka. So what the judges have unfortunately said is that that particular case, the earlier Nahal Chand case,
yeah,
was with reference to the Maharashtra Act.
Yeah.
And as long as A, the brochure clearly says they will charge the allottees for parking, and B, the agreement itself specifies the breakup of the charges, and you of course signed the agreement,
yeah,
then the builder has the right to charge for the parking.
Okay.
But this is not the end of anything, because there's a twist in the tail. The twist in the tail is the RERA Act.
Yeah.
Now the RERA Act defines open parking spaces as part of common areas.
Yeah.
And to my personal knowledge, at least RERA Panchkula has been continuously passing orders wherein it has said that you cannot charge for open parking spaces. You can only charge for basement parking spaces, provided it is given in the agreement, of course.
Okay.
So here's a situation where in 2020 the Supreme Court has said you can charge, but there is an act,
yeah,
which specifies at least with regard to open parking spaces.
Yeah.
So what I personally feel is, which is why I'm saying that somebody has to take a case right up to the Supreme Court solely on the issue of parking.
Yeah.
You have to remember the Nahal Chand case was only on the point of parking. It resulted in a detailed discussion and a very detailed judgment. So maybe this issue, along with the fact that there's a new RERA Act and all those other associated facts of the case, will have to be taken up to the Supreme Court, and in an appropriate manner, the Supreme Court would properly lay down the law. Hopefully, in our favor.
Yeah. So Priyanjali, that's a very positive note to end this interview on, that, you know, there is justice. It just takes a bit of time. So A, do your due diligence so that, you know, hopefully you don't have to be in the scenario where you are fighting for justice. But if you are fighting for justice, then keep the faith. So thank you so much for your time, Priyanjali. Great talking to you.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. And thank you, viewers, for tuning in. We will be back with more. Till then, stay safe, stay healthy.